Hey, and her gems. Today, we're going to welcome another incredible artist. She is Ariana in the Rose. So it's great to talk to you today. How are you?
Hi, I'm good. Thanks for having me.
So just to start off, when did you first know you wanted to pursue music and start it really as a career?
Good question. I wanted to be a performer. I started in theater. So I was really young. I was like 13 or 14 when I first started working in theater. And then I guess it wasn't until I was in college that I really realized that I wanted to write music instead. So I put a band together and then sort of been doing music ever since. So it was a late start knowing I wanted to be a musician, but performing since I was really little.
So then how did you pick the title of Ariana in the Rose?
My gosh, this is a really funny story, actually. I'm in LA right now. I live in New York. And one of my best friends actually named my project, and I was with her the other day. She said to me, she was like, remember when I named your band? And it's still the name of your band. She was my roommate, and my middle name is Rose. And she, I was just like, we were just sitting in our living room, and I was like, I have to name my band. Like, I don't know what to name it. And I knew I wanted it to be Ariana and the something. And I just came up with like really horrible names, like Ariana and the Starfish, and like really bad ones. And she was like, you can't do that. Like, you can't go out into the world with those. And so she was like, you should just call it basically your name, Ariana and the Rose. And that was it. So she was kidding. She was like, I want like a percentage of like all the things since I named the band. It was funny.
That's a great story.
Thanks.
So how exactly then did you develop your style and sense of music and like picked a genre as an artist? And do you see that evolving in any way as since you started out or as you see yourself continuing music?
That's a good question. I think that's sort of the like struggle of all artists and musicians when they first start is figuring out what your sound is and like what you want to do. And I think that that always changes over time. I mean, if you look at like any artist and you look at like the beginning stuff, you can hear like the inklings of like what they end up becoming. And I think I always loved synth pop music. I loved pop, but I think I didn't get into like pushing it into of like a darker place or a more like alternative place until maybe I got older. So I ended up like having to sort of like, I ended up moving to London and like that changed my whole perspective on music. And they do like really cool electronic music there, artists like Churches and things like that. So that really influenced me. So I don't know if I'll ever move away from using synths and stuff. I just love those sounds. I love Robin. I love making music that makes people want to dance. But maybe I'm sure as I make more things sort of like ebb and flow and maybe it's more live or less live, but I think I'll always at the core of it want to make music that like makes people feel good and like they want to move.
Nice. So how do you write songs? Where do you draw your inspiration and what's your process like? Because your songs are all really amazing and I feel like all have really deep messages and come from like a really personal place, at least to the listener. So what's that sort of like on your end writing them?
Thank you. Well, I'm glad that is how they resonate. I mean, they do come from a personal place. I feel like for me, that was always something that bothered me, that people felt like if you were writing music that had a dance beat or you were writing music that like had something that made you move, that like it was somehow meant that like the message wouldn't be real, you know, that it wouldn't come from like something that felt like your own personal experience. So I always want to write lyrics that are my own. So I write a lot with other people and I write a lot by myself. I play piano. So a lot of times songs start as like just my own. It's like me and a piano or I make a demo and then I go and I work with other people to flesh out production and flesh out the song. But there's a million ways. I like writing with other people too, because sometimes when you sit in a room by yourself for like days, you're like, oh my God, I feel crazy. I don't even know if I've written anything good, but I think they're both important. So I think it's like anything. I think it's good to switch things up.
So, have you had a favorite song to work on, or that has like personally stuck with you as like a great experience, or something that you're really proud of putting out there?
It's a good one. When I wrote Super Cool, so the people that I wrote Super Cool with, actually, it was probably like the fourth or fifth song we had written together, but I remember very specifically being in a writing room with them. This was years ago. And it was the first writing session I did where I was like, we wrote a song called Breathe that actually never came out. And we ended up writing another song later called Give Up the Ghost, which I put out, and then Super Cool. But I remember thinking to myself, like, oh my God, this is how you make a record. Like, this is how people write music. This is, oh my, these people are so talented. And I think that was like probably the first time that I really started to find my sound too, a little bit, going back to your original question. So, yeah, I think that was probably a time that stuck out to me. And we had like these synths going, and we were all like dancing in the studio. And yeah, I think that was probably it. Which is funny because it's a song that never came out. So go figure, right? It's not everything is always about your most streamed song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I also have to ask, what do you think fans and followers should be expecting of any new music, or should we think of anything being in the works or coming soon, or?
So I'm making new music now. I actually have a feature coming out on a song this Friday on the 19th, called Bones, which is a song which is by this Australian group, Phoenix Paul, and this other producer named Harley Knox. So I'm just featuring on that, which was really fun to sing something that I hadn't written and, you know, was sort of someone else's thing. It was sort of fun to jump on someone else's world for a second and sing. But in terms of my own music, I'm making a bunch of stuff. It will be out sooner rather than later, I promise. And it's like we're living in like some like we've got some like disco vibes coming in, some like really good, like get everyone feeling good before they go out. I just feel like the world needs a little bit of that right now. So, but still, you know, still the same old like. I'm always like talking about something. I don't know if I'll ever write a song where you listen to it and you're like, I have no idea what she's saying. This sounds like she's lost it. So it's always important to me that I'm writing from an experience.
Okay, so sort of like switching off of music and now sort of into some things that have happened to you in 2017. You were put on the list of the 50 most powerful quotes for independent artists in 2017. And your quote was, "The dream is free and the hustle is sold separately. Being an independent artist, it's about having perseverance." So, what was that like for you to be put on that list? And what sort of like message are you trying to continually send, sort of like based off that quote or anything you would want to add to that?
The list is based off of a distribution and a label platform called AWOL, which is Artist Without a Label, which is the platform that I put my music out through and the label that I go through. And they're huge supporters of independent artists because that's what their distribution is. And I had done an interview with them. That quote's actually pulled from an interview that I had done with them like a while back. So I think it's something that when I started in music, I never really thought that the things that I was talking about in terms of like the like journey of being an artist, I don't think I ever registered that like that would become a part of my actual story. And the more music I put out and the shows that I get to play, I find that it's important to be talking about that, and it's important to be talking to people about making your own path, whether it's in music or in journalism or in anything. I think that like getting up and saying like, I'm not going to wait for someone to give me a job, I'm not going to wait for someone to open the door for me to do what I love, is important. So I think that that's a message that I'll be talking about more.
So then, besides this particular moment, what do you think was like your biggest moment in 2017? It could be a good moment, a bad moment, something that shaped you. What do you think was like your moment in 2017?
Okay, well, I have like a real answer, but for real, I got a dog in 2017, and that legitimately was my biggest moment. Like no joke. I was like at Christmas, my manager and my team and I were like sitting around being like, what was everyone's like favorite moment? And I was like, I got a dog. And everyone was like, you, okay, thank you. Like, thanks, great. And I was like, it's changed my life. It actually has changed my life, but that's wouldn't be my professional moment. What would be my moment of 2017? God, I mean, I created a show called Light and Space, which is an immersive event. It's a combination of theater and a concert and a party. So it's like this whole like galactic inspired party, and everyone has like glitter on and body paint, and we do a big show in the middle of it. It's very fun. And so we did that for the first time in November in New York. And that was probably my biggest moment. It felt like it was sold out, it was packed, and it was just like a room full of people with glitter on, dancing with like all these characters that I had created with my creative team. And the idea is that we're all sort of these like pop aliens that like came down to like make everyone have a really fun time. And just like looking at that crowd of people just dancing and having a really great night, I just thought to myself, like, God, this is the only place that I want to be. So it was one of those moments where you're like, cool, all the things that have happened in life, like at least they brought you to here. So that was definitely my moment, plus my cute dog.
That's great. So I have one final question, and mm-hmm. that would be, if you were to recommend to us one or two growing or like emerging unheard artists that we need to listen to, who would you recommend?
That's good. Okay, I don't know if she's like growing, because she's like definitely like way bigger than I am. But I think Bishop Briggs is like pretty great. She's not really growing. I feel like she's pretty established at this point. But there's a lot of people who still don't know about her, and her music's unbelievable. So Bishop Briggs is one of them. For ages, for like years, I was saying Dua Lipa, which is crazy because now she's a pop star. So I can't say Dua Lipa anymore. 'Cause 2 years ago, I was like, there's this girl I'm obsessed with named Dua Lipa. And now she's like the star queen she should be, because she's a literal queen. So like truly emerging artists, let's think about this. I work with a band called Me Not You, which are really amazing. It's a duo, and they're like alt rock, and they're so cool, and they just got off tour. And they're really great. I would check out their music.
Will do. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to do this interview with us. It's great to hear from you and other artists that are still making their way in the music world, because you guys are the next big thing in music, and I can't wait to see what you guys all do.
Thank you so much. I can't wait to see what you do.